Okay, so we are now on the last section and the last two lectures on rigid body kinetics. So we are going to finish everything on Wednesday, and hopefully I'll have everything that I need to make that sort of complete. So today is just going to be, first of all, a summary, just a reminder of what we've talked about, and just a reminder of what linear momentum is. So we go from second law, we break it into its dv/dt terms, we do the integration, and we end up with this expression over here. And it's the same expression you had for particles, t1, t2, fdt equals mvg2, mvg1. The only difference is that instead of looking at particles, you're looking at the center of mass. Where things get tricky with particles.
Okay, there we go.
We can do all sorts of things in terms of looking at individual particles. So if we have a particle which is traveling with a v sub I, and we have a center of mass which has a velocity v sub g, we can of course reference everything with respect to that point. And so vi becomes vg, and here I've sort of broken it into two-dimensional components, so it's a bit easier for me, and I get vi in terms of vgx and vy, and omega k cross with the distance x bar and y bar, I and j. H sub gi then, you can do the cross multiplication, so to put all the terms in, you end up with the moment of inertia, r squared dn. So I got an interesting question today in office hours, and I'm preparing a slide or a set of slides that I'll present probably on Wednesday, looking at where exactly this term is coming from in terms of angular momentum for I. The important thing, and this is something that keeps coming up on Piazza, is remember that when you're dealing with things in terms of motion, you got to sort of consider everything. So translation, you have L equals mvg, hg equals zero, motion is parallel, it's again, first type of motion. Everything about the center of mass is zero. Everything about another point on the body, say for example I declare or I'm interested in some other point A, and sometimes I am, that will not be a moment or an angular momentum. For rotation, you can do everything about the center of mass. So you have LMVG, HG equals IG omega, or more likely and more often, you're going to be shifting to the point of rotation. And that point of rotation is O in this case. And that rotation shifting occurs essentially through the parallel axis theory. So if I write this as IG, RG, and recognize VG as RG omega, I end up with I naught omega here. And we've done these derivations a number of times, so there's not much value to redoing it. When dealing with general plane motion, there's not much you can do. And so you just have the standard sort of relationships, which are L equals mvg, hg equals ig. Okay. So typically, the best thing to do, and again, this is something I'm kind of finding in the discussion, and this is one of the reasons why Piazza exists, is I really do want to encourage you, we are not trying to punish you by making you draw things. We just want you to put together a really good physical understanding of what's happening. As well, when you do units, it actually helps you a great deal because you can check and see things often a lot quicker than you might see otherwise without doing it. So you'll notice that in the lecture, and also if you look at my old PDF files, if you cannot access the OneNote, you have plenty of examples to work from. They're pretty much as clear as I can make them. I'm happy to talk about them afterwards, but please try and just go through stuff for now. I'm thinking thinking about the fund. So I have two spheres on a system, A and B. The two solid spheres, they have a mass of 0.92 kilos and a, there I go, I tell you to use units. Two solid spheres are on a spinning rod. The I sub R is given at the rod of 0.35 kilos, kilogram meter squared, and omega equals 6 rads per second. The spheres are cut, but are held by a spring which is cut, and find omega at A prime and B prime and the loss of energy. So at the first position, you have a rotation which is going to be I of the rod, omega 1, and then you have I of the sphere, omega 1, and you have I of the sphere, omega 1. You have MVA1, MVA1, or VB1. And they're all a distance R1 apart. You're going to spend a lot of time looking at spinning systems to try to start to draw out what those features are. So when I'm looking at this particular case, I know that I have a moment of inertia of the rod, which means that when I'm solving for it, I'm going to have to consider that in the solution. These two spheres, I know something about them. And then, I have a pin reaction. So I have Ry dt, and I have Rx dt. So those are the impulses that would be delivered. And the other thing that I know is that I of a sphere is equal to 2 fifths ma squared. A being the radius of the sphere, 2 fifths ma squared is not one that we expect you to know. So we wouldn't say, okay, here's a sphere and we expect you to know this one. No, but you might get it like this, where you're given that information. Then at the end, you have MVA2, MVA2, or VB2. You have IR omega R2, or well, why do that? Omega 2. I of the sphere, omega 2. I of the sphere, omega 2. So the spheres are rotating in the counterclockwise direction, same direction as the rod, and everything's sort of going in the same sense. And I can start to write 2 times m of the sphere, r1, omega 1, r1 plus I of the sphere, omega 1, plus I r omega 1, equals 2 times mass of the sphere R2 omega 2 R2 plus I S omega 2 plus I R omega 2. And so when you're dealing, go ahead. Which line?
The second with the Ry and T and Ry.
So those are the reaction forces at the pin. They would be the impulses delivered. Right? What do you expect? What is the form of the angular momentum equation that you expect to see? You expect to see all of the individual momenta. So let's go back to this.
Actually, I'm going to go forward a little bit. So here, this is the momenta of each of the spheres. This is the momenta of the angular momenta of the spheres. So we have to take the linear velocity, multiply it by mass, multiply it times its radius, and then, by times its radius. R omega is just the velocity of the sphere, right? I s omega 2 is the angular momenta of those spheres. Now, the rod itself has a momenta, and it's not translated. So it's rotating about its center. Now, of course, I have included the reaction forces, those Rx, Ry, in there, but they're not doing anything because they don't cause a moment about the center. So if I'm drawing out my impulse diagram and I'm looking down on an object, it's not, you know, the gravity, the weight terms are not playing a role. There's nothing else left. Not clear on this. There's a small string that connects these bar things at first. Then it's snapped. And then they're free to move out. So they start at A, they go to A prime, and B, and go to B prime.
Okay.
And they start at 13 centimeters, and they end up at 65. Okay? So all of the impulse terms, those are the reaction forces at the center, which I drew in my diagram for completeness, because hey, you should, doesn't play a role. Because they don't cause a moment. On the other hand, it starts here and moves out here. And it sort of rotates around. So in terms of conservation of angular momenta, it's the angular velocity, essentially the angular velocity of the spheres. And the other thing I should mention right here is, hey, doesn't this look like the parallel axis theorem? So it's I of the sphere plus mr squared times omega 1, I of the sphere plus omega m plus mr 2 squared times omega. The only ones that are sort of separate and can't be added in there is IR, and it's added in the totality. So at the end, you end up with omega, which is equal to 2 rads, 2.107 rads per second. So as much as you can. This is not a bad problem. It's kind of a nice, relatively simple sort of geometry. Things move in. This is your ice skater problem, but with moments of inertia. The ice skater problem is always the ice skater starts with their arms out, the ice skater brings the arms in. In this case, the ice skater is bringing the arms out. So, one of the things that I think in the future this course should cover, but we don't. And I think it's useful because there's enough PUI jobs where you end up doing something along those lines, is coefficient of restitution. So in this case, for example, I have two boxes, one A and B, and they're approaching each other with VAX minus VBX minus, and after impact, they have a velocity. I'm not going to put a direction yet on it because it doesn't matter to me. They may move together, they may bounce off of each other, but each of those are different conditions. So in that case, E is equal to VBX plus minus VAX plus over VAX minus minus VBX minus. Okay, so you have three cases that can happen, and often in this course we have plastic impact. That is, two objects come together and then they have the same final velocity. And because they have the same final velocity, E is going to equal zero, and then they sort of go off. E equals one, they have the same but reversed velocities and they sort of impact and go off in the same direction. Or some form of elastic impact between the two cases. Okay, so it's not covered in the course, and I understand that. You were asked also for the lost energy. And so going back, you always lose energy. No matter what you do, you always lose energy. And so when you're looking at the impact, you just calculate it. What is important here, again, is recognizing what the terms are in the energy equation that you have. You have the translational terms, you have the rotational terms. The rod, of course, only rotates. It doesn't translate. And because of that, you only have one term. So you've added all the terms together. You can calculate for both the third or the two cases, roughly 66% of the energy has been lost. Any questions on this? I snuck in my elastic plastic impacts on that. So you're going to face a lot of problems looking at things like this. Let's see. Oh, this is a good one. And I'll try not to be as quick in terms of the description this time, is that you're dealing with really complex motion. And one of the problems with complex motion is you often try to fill in pieces. Don't fill in things that don't exist. This is a problem that exists as it is. And let's start looking at it and put together the free body diagram, which is probably the most important first step. So I have a spool of mass 35 kilograms, and I have a cord which I've attached at the edge of the inner diameter, and I'm pulling vertically on that cord with a force of 120 newtons. The cord remains vertical as whatever motion occurs,
big R is 0.3 meters, kg of the spool is 0.18 meters. The spool starts from rest and rolls without slip. You're asked to find the speed of the spool center at t equals 3 seconds, and the minimum mu sub s for rolling without slip. So both of those conditions are standard conditions that you've seen in the past. You know that you're starting to see more problems where you have to determine whether slip will or will not occur. But the other thing, too, is I have a force, I have a velocity, and I have a time. I have a force which is applied, I have a wave acting downward, I have the speed of the spool center that I want to know, and a time equals 3 seconds. So this is a momentum problem. I have a rotation, so I expect it's going to be a conservation angular momentum. So if I go to this, I have P, which is acting upwards. I have force of the friction. I expect the rotation to be clockwise, and I expect the friction to be acting in that direction. I have a normal force acting upwards, and I have weight. And weight acts through the center of mass. And I can define a coordinate system, x, y, positive, counterclockwise as usual, which is good because I didn't mess up how I was defining things. The first equation I have is my x linear momentum equation. I'm not going to worry about the y momentum because there's no y velocity. So vgy1 equals vgy2, but vgx1 does not equal vgx2. Let's see, that's 1, so I'm going to call that 1. I have 2. For the second one, I have everything about the center of mass. So I have ig omega s1, which is the initial angular velocity of the system, plus the impulse delivered. Now, the impulse delivered will only come from this term and this term because these two terms act through the center of mass. So weight acts through the center of mass, the normal acts through the center of mass. Force of friction causes a counterclockwise moment, so that's good, I got that right. And this one causes a clockwise moment. And so it's going to be opposite signed. And so, again, as you draw these out, it's a lot easier for you to check what your results are. You can do this as a vector, too, right? If you're really excited, you can do it that way, and it works really well, too. I don't have to do very much with the moment of inertia. I'm given the radius of gyration. Now the system starts at rest. Now, you should be used to the idea of if you're going to use a standard coordinate system and you know that you expect that the velocity will be positive, so VGX2 is positive, R is going to be positive, but this has to be negative. Now, if you do it as a vector product, of course, it will pop out directly. You don't have to do it as a vector product. All you have to do is recognize that that would be opposite sign. So you have to recognize what the direction of the rotation is going to be. So this is going to be clockwise. And so in order for it to be clockwise and moving forward, we expect that that will be a negative value.
So we got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 equations. So if I go to my equation 1, I can immediately take this and I can write T1, T2, force of friction dt equals mvdx2. And if I do my equation 2, I can sort of do this, which is R is constant, so T1, T2, force of friction dt minus PR delta t, that's the time over which this has occurred, equals minus m kg squared divided by r, vg, vgx2. Okay.
So all I'm doing is I'm taking the first two equations, the angular momentum equations, and the linear momentum equation, and lining them up, and not lining them up very well.
Sure, this is good. And lining them up well,
and in the process of doing that, I have now a way, or a term I want to get rid of. I can get rid of the friction if I multiply this across by R. So if I do that, I end up by
I end up with this term right here.
So I end up that the final velocity of the system, or the velocity, is 7.56 meters per second. Now, the other thing I was asked for is what do I need to have as a minimum coefficient of static friction? Maybe just one. I mean, there's some steps in between, nothing major. Once you multiply by R, you sort of add the terms left, and you can sort of separate out the changes. But again, very complex motion. Lots of things happening. If you're looking at that motion and you're looking at that problem, it can be a bit overwhelming at the beginning. But really, once you've done this right here, the solution becomes a lot more obvious. And it's really important that you are able to draw really well these free body diagrams and not worry or imagine extra terms on them. Once you do that, this becomes, okay, it is a it's an angular momentum or a momentum problem. Here are the linear momentum components. Here's the angular momentum components.
So if we go back to that free body diagram, an expert will draw two circles. We have normal, force of friction, P, and mg. And what we're asked for is the minimum mu sub s. So in this case, N plus P equals mg. N is equal to mg minus P. And force of friction, minimum, equals mu sub s min mg minus P. And this is the case of impending slip.
So you take it right to its maximum value. So you know that that's going to have to be whatever, you know, that
those numbers end up being. So if I add them up together and I just say, hey, let's go back to that equation that we already know and look at the sum of forces in the x direction, substitute in terms, we end up at, or the angular or linear momentum equation. You end up with P, and I will be able to write this, R squared mg minus P divided by R squared plus kg squared, which equals 0.39. So out of that, you have kind of, again, a relatively powerful result. This is equation one. Again. So from that, you have a relatively powerful result that doesn't require a great deal of effort. Okay, so then you get that. Everything solved in vectors, or sorry, in terms of variables, and then you have an answer that comes out of the question. Again, this is kind of a nice problem to think about and to look at from the perspective of what you can sort of do with these techniques. All right, this one. Ooh, plenty of time. All right. You also have really kind of weirdish problems that you start with. So to investigate a new launching system, an experiment is designed that uses a 2 by 8 meter square plate with a mass of 4,500 kilos. Knowing a plate is released from rest and falls vertically 2 meters before the cord becomes taut, determine the angular velocity of the plate immediately after the cord is taut. So this becomes a little bit tricky because you kind of, again, you're trying to imagine what the problem is. Don't imagine. have. So if I look at sort of the forces, and I've helpfully drawn all of these out for me, I have the linear momentum of the plate as it drops. I have the reaction force of the cord at the corner, so R delta T at the weight, but you can kind of ignore that usually, so I don't have too much about that. Let's see. That's about it. All right. And I have the final sort of result. I put sort of a weird direction. I'm assuming counterclockwise, but you know, if I were to guess, it probably would go this way, but okay. MVGX prime, MVGY prime, and IG omega. So, if I look at the moments about B, those are going to be coming from a combination of the velocities here and the angular velocity of the system. So, X momenta. From the x, I have no forces acting in the x direction at this moment. Nothing is causing a movement or a shift of the object in either direction. On the other hand, I can add in all the terms and sort of, I think I've jumped ahead a little bit in this, but for the moments about B, it's going to be V times A over 2, so VGX is 0 from that, VGY is the only term that's playing a role. And that's acting distance A over 2. And omega prime A over 2 equals VGY prime. So I have enough information. I have the angular velocity of the system. I have the entire, I don't have a term that's going to play a role from X. I only have a term that's going to play a role from Y. So all the terms are added up. And so my initial, and final momenta
for the angular velocity, or the angular momentum can be calculated directly. So I have initially only a downward velocity. At the end, I only have, or I have a combination of angular velocities and linear downward velocities. And again, the thing about this is that this is occurring at a relatively short period of time. And that's it. Yeah.
just want to check one thing because I have to flip out in a weird way.
Well, I'm going to actually solve it. I'm not going to write my formula because I can tell my time is not right. 4.164 rads per second. So if you put in all the numbers, you put in all the values, you have omega, you don't have omega. You have the initial velocity of the system, you put everything together, you end up with 1.4 t rads per second. Questions on this? These are not really involved questions until you get to one that is. Truck pulls with a force of P equals 500 newtons over 2 seconds, and find minimum use of S for rolling without slip. So you know you're going to have a velocity at the end. You have a K sub G, the radius of gyration of the spool, which is an inner radius of 1.3 meters, 1.8 meters. The radius of gyration is given as 1.2 meters. There's a truck. Truck is moving to the left. A right, and all you're asked is mu sub s. So you have time, velocity, because you're looking for mu sub s here, you know it's a velocity because it's rolling, and you have time, velocity, and force. So all of that is what you need to sort of do this. Okay. So mg. Force of friction, normal, and P. Throw that back up.
Again, a relatively simple free body diagram for what does look like a very complex kind of motion.
So you have kg, you have everything there, you have forces, same thing as before. Xy, and as before, I'm going to start by solving this problem for mass of the spool vgx1 plus the integral t1, t2, T plus, I really should stop writing subscripts, dt equals ms vgx2. And that should look like a G. So that's my linear expression. I have all the terms I need there. I have the spool, omega of the spool 1, plus the integrals T1 to T2, F times cap R minus P times little r, dt equals I g omega S2. So I have the initial and the final momenta plus the impulse delivered over the time at which the pulling is occurring. And IG is equal to MKG squared. Yeah, well, that's good. VGX1 equals 0, omega S1 equals 0, omega S2 equals, again, this strange construct, VGX2 over R, which allows me again to use my vector notation and my vector conventions in order to correctly define. define all of the motion. So omegas will be negative when the velocity is positive. As we did before, you can write all of this out, and you can see, for example, what I'm going to try and do is get rid of, not that, the force, the friction force, right there. So I can write that as T1 to T2 of F dt plus P delta T equals MS VGX2, and R T1 to T2 F dt minus PR delta T equals minus MS KG squared over R VG. So substituting in variables, first getting rid of these terms right here, allows me to write VGX2 equals R plus R P delta T all over MS R squared plus K G squared VGX2 equals 5.96 meters per second. So substituting all the terms, I know what the velocity is at the end, I know everything that I need, and I got 2 minutes. Force of friction min, and the normal is equal to mass of spool times g, delta t equals 2 seconds, force min equals mu sub s min n, which is mu sub s min mg. Integrating T1 to T2 of mu sub s min MSG dt plus P delta T equals MS, substituting in terms, R plus R P. Delta T all over MS. R squared plus KG squared, you end up with a mu sub S min of 0.049. Very different than the last one where we had a really large one, it was about 0.4. So about 10 times smaller. Again, really kind of interesting, the type of information